Good morning, Christ community, and welcome to our Sunday morning broadcast. I'm Pastor Archie. So glad you have joined in on this Palm Sunday. You know, Palm Sunday is the Sunday before Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, was crucified on Good Friday. But aren't you glad that's not how the story ended? He got up with all power on Sunday morning. We are headed to Resurrection Week, and we're going to celebrate this week with a great bevy of activities as we celebrate the life and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are grateful. I hope you're doing well. You know how we roll. Make sure you hit somebody up in the chat. Give them a big welcome. Give them a big hug. We're going to be in person very soon. So we're going to continue to do the online thing, but that in-person thing is coming very, very soon. So glad you're joining us today. Know that I miss you. We are working on a few things. Just to let you know, if you haven't done it, make sure you sign up, as we will be on the parking lot for Easter next Sunday, and I surely will be looking for you. Slots are going very, very fast, and so make sure you sign up. We're going to have a great time next Sunday on the lot, and so I really want you to be there. We are also working on our in-person services. That's coming very, very soon as we are coming out of this situation. Amen. COVID has had too much of a stranglehold on all of us. So we're coming out. More information is coming on that very, very soon. But also what I want to give you is that this week coming up is what we're calling Miracles Still Happen Week. It is our Easter Resurrection Week celebration. Every day at noon, Monday through Friday, will be a time of prayer on Facebook. Check your social media outlets and pages that we offer here at CC, at Christ Community, as to how to connect with that. Also to my very, very good friend, Pastor Jeremy Upton, will be bringing the lesson for the Wednesday service, our Wednesdays in the Word, for our Miracles Still Happen. You do not want to miss that. He pastors the Refuge Church in the Miami area, longtime friend, an incredible expositor of the Word of God. You want to show up on Wednesdays in the Word and meet with him. We're going to have a great time in the Word. And so if you've marked your calendar for that, this is going to be a great Resurrection Week celebration. Well, that's all I have. I've done enough talking. It is time for the offering. There are many ways that you can give right there on the screen. Go ahead and do that. We surely appreciate all you're doing. We're doing greater things in the community because of you. We are serving the needs of people with food and all different kinds of services because you are investing in this ministry. We got a lot more to do in his name because we are a difference-making church. Thank you so much. Appreciate you so much for the gifts that you invest in this ministry. Well, I've talked enough, y'all. It's time to get our praise on. We celebrate Palm Sunday because this is the Sunday that our Lord went into Jerusalem, headed to the cross. But you know that's not how the story is, because in 3 days, he got up. He rose again from the dead, and we celebrate that. So let's get our praise on with the Brush Trade team on this planet. Let's give him the praise. God bless you.
Looking back on where we've come from, it's because of you and nothing we have done to deserve the love and mercy you've shown. But your grace was strong enough to pick us up, and you made a way when our backs were against
wall.
And you looked
and
as
it
if
looked as if it was
oh, so Lord, you made a way. And we're standing here,
and we're standing here
only because
you made.
Oh Lord, you
made a way
when our backs were against
when
the wall.
Our backs were against the wall.
And it looked
and
as
it
if
it was
oh,
we're standing here only because you made a way.
Lord, we celebrate you this Palm Sunday, this Sunday that signifies your love for us as you were preparing to go to the cross. We thank you for that as we come up on our resurrection season. Bless our week of miracles still happen. Bless our experience on Friday, Good Friday, as we recall the crucifixion. And then most importantly, bless us next Sunday as we celebrate the resurrection. Now, God, speak to our hearts today as we kind of continue in this whole communication goals, Lord, to help us be better in our relationships and how we talk to each other. Because, Lord, we want to have good conversation with the people we love that we might experience your presence. We love you, Lord, for all that you'll say and do this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning to you all. Glad you are able to join us for this broadcast. This is Palm Sunday, as we have indicated. Sunday, we celebrate the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem, the Sunday before his crucifixion, and of course, the Sunday before his resurrection. We're getting ready for resurrection season, and we're going to have a great experience as we move forward in that. Just a couple of things. We have had some individuals that completed Next Steps and united with us. I just want to point them out very quickly. Let's celebrate and welcome to the Christ Community family, John and Sharon Jones of Dallas and Ray Jean Craft of Dallas. Y'all, let's go ahead and celebrate both all of these individuals as they have completed Next Steps. And if you're watching this broadcast, or if you just want to find out more about Christ Community and you're not quite ready to partner with us, that is our next steps. We would love for you to participate in that. That's how you connect with Christ Community. We have a calling as a community, and we are a difference-making community. We'd love for you to be a part of that. We thank you for sharing with us every Sunday, but God has a greater calling for you, and we would love for you to be a part of that. Again, congratulations to the Jones and the Kraft. Ms. Kraft, we surely appreciate you all. I want to continue with what we started on last week as we deal with our communication goals. I want to invite your attention back to Acts chapter 15. We dealt with the church fight in the first 35 verses, and then Paul and Barnabas, two apostolic pillars of the faith, they have their own falling out. As we're going to discover, when it comes to communication problems, even the great apostles of history are not immune from this deadly disease. And so I want to read the Message version in your hearing, Acts chapter 15, verses 36 through 41. Acts 15, verses 36 through 41. And here's how it reads in the Message version. After a few days of this, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let's go back and visit all of our friends in each of the towns where we preached the word of God. Let's see how they're doing." Barnabas wanted to take John along, the John nicknamed Mark, but Paul wouldn't have him. He wasn't about to take along a quitter who, as soon as the going got tough, had jumped ship on them in Pamphylia. Tempers flared, and they ended up going their separate ways. Barnabas said, "Fine, I'm done with you, Paul," and took Mark and sailed to Cyprus. That's not in your text. That's an Autry translation. Paul said, "Fine, I never liked you in the first place." Chose Silas and offered up by their friends to the grace of the master. Went to Syria and Cilicia to build muscle and sinew in the congregation. Just having a little fun. That's an Autry added addendum there. And I want to continue this conversation. We no longer talk, we attack, part two. I want to conclude what I started. We no longer talk, we attack. And last week, that's the proposition that we put forward. I believe that kind of defines our culture. I believe that defines many of our relationships, our families. Sadly, we've become a culture in which we no longer talk, but we attack. We no longer talk, we attack. I recently heard a theologian in a podcast who also captured this sentiment with this quote, and here's what he said. "We live in a day in which we are not having conversations, but instead we are launching accusations and recriminations." In other words, our conversations are simply opening salvos for an extended, entrenched warfare against each other. In a word, we no longer talk, we attack. We no longer talk, we attack. And thus, our families are no longer safe zones, but now they've become war zones. Because we no longer talk, we attack. Single men and women are as divided as spouses. Because we no longer talk, we attack. Husbands and wives are no longer playmates, but instead they've settled and become roommates. Because we no longer talk, we attack. Churches are competing as the number one hospital in this country, where church hurt is real. Because we no longer talk, we attack. And the divide between parents and children is widening with each new generation. Because we no longer talk, we attack. Would you type that in the chat? We no longer talk, we attack. And the question is, can God deliver us from our communication issues? Is God able to deliver us from this allegedly unending, spiraling cycle of conflict and nasty communication? How does the Spirit of God engage our conversations to be healthier, that we all may have better relationships with one another? And I want to be really honest with you today here at the forefront of this word. This is a conversation today. And so type in the chat, we're going to have a conversation today. I would love to tell you that today's principle that I want to submit to you that God laid on my heart is the cure-all to all of your communication problems. I would love to say that God is going to give us a magic wand today and just magically make all of our communication differences go away. But the truth is, you and I know it rarely works that way. Matter of fact, if it came easy, God probably was not in it. You can tweet that. The truth is, in our text, it surely didn't come easy for Paul and Barnabas. Why in the world would we think it would come easy for us? As a matter of fact, God loves to teach us how to grow through it rather than to give us an instant plucking out of it. The truth is, I'm just going to tell you up front, even the principle that I'm going to share with you today, there are no easy way around our communication issues here. And so, Pastor, you may be saying, what are you proposing? Here's what I'm proposing. I'm proposing, first and foremost, if we're going to address our communication differences, if we're going to deal with the nasty conflicts in our relationships, our families, with our loved ones, it's going to come down to one simple issue. It's going to come down to faith. Like any other challenge in our lives, when we find ourselves in those difficult places, likewise, with our communication, it's going to take a step of faith to trust God's way to overcome our communication differences. And most of you know that's exactly how God moves. God has a way of navigating our lives where he brings us to a crossroad. He brings us to the fork, the metaphorical fork in the road of conflict. And he asks you and I the question, do you want to take the low road? Or do you want to take the high road? Do you want to take the low road and go ahead and just get it all out of your system, give full vent to your anger, call them everything but a child of God, not only give them a piece of your mind, but give them all your mind? Because the truth is, everybody doesn't know what they did to you, and you feel justified in saying it, and you might be justified. But if you do that, 9 times out of 10, we know God is not in it. We know God is not with us. And if the truth be told, instead of helping bridge that relationship, we set it back even further, maybe 15 or 20 years. Do we really want to travel the low road? Or do we want to take a step of faith and walk with God and travel the high road? No, there are not any promises on the high road that it's going to be easy. Matter of fact, it may be just as difficult as the low road. But the difference between the low road and the high road, God will be with us. God won't leave us in the fight by ourselves. And what we'll discover is that more often than not, we'll see how God works on us to make us a better person rather than the people that we have issue with. And while we're going through it, we will watch and see how God works on us. And how he will use even the greatest difficulty to make us a better people. That's what he does. We'll watch him in terms of how he changes us. We'll watch him as he works on us and teaches us how to stay calm in the midst of chaos. We'll watch him as he teaches us how we can take our worst wounds and turn them into a great win. We'll watch him as he teaches us how to parse our words in a way that we build bridges instead of blowing them up or tearing them down. We'll even watch him build us up as our fierce enemies do everything in their power to tear us down. That's the question really before us today if we want to resolve our communication differences. Do we want to take the high road or the low road? That's the challenge, and that is a step of faith. I want to tell you a quick story before we launch into this. Former Supreme Court Justice, the late Ruth Bader Ginsburg, shares a story about some advice that her mother-in-law gave her on her wedding day. Ruth Bader Ginsburg and her husband had been married for some 56 years, and she credits this advice to be the one single element that has helped her and her husband navigate their differences. They too have had huge disagreements. They too have had threats of divorce. They too went through seasons of silence. But this one piece of advice is what helped them to keep things together for 56 years. And she said on that day, her mother-in-law said this to her, I'm going to give you some advice that will serve you well. In every good marriage, it pays sometimes to be a little deaf. And then after she made that statement, she gave Ruth Bader Ginsburg a pair of earplugs just like these. And she said to her, when you feel like you can't take it anymore, use this and plug your ears. In other words, what Ruth Bader Ginsburg's mother-in-law was trying to tell her is that you need to use the technique if you want to get beyond your temper. The key to getting through your differences, the key to getting through the conflict, the key to getting over the temper and the anger is to lean on the technique to get beyond it. And so that's my premise today. It's very simple. Faith means we got to lean into the technique to move beyond our temper. We got to lean into the technique to move beyond our temper. The text says between Paul and Barnabas that tempers flared. And Paul went his way and Barnabas went his. Why? They had no technique. And in that moment, that's what I believe the Spirit of God is challenging you and I. That no, it's not going to be easy. Yes, emotion's going to want to take over. Yes, that's when the Spirit leaves us. But in that moment, we got to lean into the technique so that we can move beyond our temper. It's no different than how football is played. If you've played football, if you love football, you know football is about discipline and technique. That in the game of play, sometimes you're going to get hit unfairly or you're going to get hit pretty hard. And the worst thing you can do is become emotional on the next play. Why? Because if you become emotional, you might miss a tackle. You might miss a catch. You might miss an assignment because you can't bring emotion in the football. You've got to stay with the technique. And coaches spend hours training their players. Whatever you do, no matter how mad you get, stay in your stance, stay with the technique, because if you stay with the technique, you'll make the play every time. What is God saying to us? We got to lean into the technique to move beyond our temper. And so very quickly, what I want to do today, I want to share four techniques from this passage that will help us to get beyond our temper, that we might have better communication. Set these as goals for the year and watch God move in your life. Number one, technique number one, always remember the big picture. Always remember the big picture. Because sometimes in the heat of disagreement, we get lost in the minutia and we forget what the big picture is. And for many of us, if you're like me, we even forget what we were really arguing about. And a lot of times, if you've ever been in an argument, you may find yourself saying to one another, why are we arguing over such insignificant, incidental issues? I'll tell you why. You've lost the big picture. You've forgotten what the main purpose is. Remember the big picture. And that's what Paul and Barnabas had here in verse 36. Paul says to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the brothers that came to Christ on our first missionary journey. They had some common ground. That's what we mean by big picture. The big picture is your common ground, that you always have something you agree on. And maybe the reason why there's so much conflict in family, so much conflict in the relationship, many times why there's conflict in churches, there's no big picture. What is the purpose? What is the vision? There needs to be a big picture for the family, a big picture for the marriage, a big picture for friends. Why are we here and what is our purpose? And then when you have one, you got to remember that, because it's easy to get lost in the details, church, friends, family. It's easy to forget why we're even arguing. And before you know it, you're far separate over issues that never should have separated you. Would you type that in the chat? Remember the big picture? The big picture is we're trying to raise a family together. And we may disagree as to how we go about it. You may have some strong opinions about that. I have some strong opinions about that. You were raised one way. I was raised a different way. But the truth is, the big picture is we want the best for our family. We want the best for our children. We want the best for us. Let's see if there's a way that we can work through this together if we stay on the big picture. The big picture is we both have needs in this relationship. You have needs, I have needs, and your needs are just as strong as mine. They may be different, but we all have needs in this relationship, and we can't put one need above the other, but we got to put them on the table and see if there's a way that we can work together so that we both experience the mutual satisfaction that we want. We have a common ground here that we can share together. The big picture is that even as people in ministry, we want the best for the people that God sends to Christ's community. And as ministry leaders and ministry people, we surely may disagree as to how we approach that. We may have differing convictions as to how we ought to share that, but we all agree we want the best for the people that God sends our way. Why? Because we know what God did for us. We know what God did in this place for us. We know that if God touches people by the grace of God, we'll always be a little bit better. We got to remember the big picture. Number one, remember the big picture. Number two, take the need to win out of the conversation. Take the need to win out of the conversation. And I know that's tough because many times when you're in the argument in the heat of battle, it's about win at all costs. I'm surely guilty of that. But what I've discovered is as I get older, everybody loses when winning is the goal. And you got to ask yourself the question, is the win important or is resolution and a healthy relationship more important? And if the win is important, I'm telling you, many times we will end up being by ourselves. What I love about this text, look what it says, tempers flared. And they ended up going their separate ways. Why they went their separate ways, the text doesn't tell us. I've read a number of commentaries, and everybody wants to know, well, who was right? Who was wrong? Did Paul say something inappropriate? Did Barnabas cross a line? And what I love about Luke in this text, he doesn't say what's wrong. That's a footnote that some things need to remain behind closed doors. Some things may need to remain sacred. Some things need to remain between two people or within family. And surely I'm not advocating nasty secrets that can tear up and break hearts. But some conversations ought to be private. And they ought to stay that way. And when we publicly shame, we are not interested in the relationship. We're only interested in saving face and ourselves. So, yes, I'm going to say a word about Carrion and Kirk. I'm going to say a word. And surely nobody's debating or arguing if Carrion was out of line. Of course he was out of line. I think he would even admit that he was out of line if he came to that place. But then Kirk's apology was not the best apology, y'all. He apologized to us for the language he used. But in the apology, he also gave a parting shot. A parting shot as if somehow he was righteous in this and Carrion was unrighteous. The truth is, that was none of our business. Because technically what apology is, a true apology, is I was wrong, I never should have used profanity, there's no justification for it on any level, I have no excuse, I apologize, period. And the problem in our communication, y'all, is that when we apologize, we don't want to put a period behind the apology. And you need to type that in the chat. Put a period behind your apology. Don't put any commentary. Don't add any footnotes to it. Don't send some addendum letters. No, I apologize. I was wrong. Period. Because we got to take the need out to win. And when we do that, we're just trying to one up. We're trying to win. We're not trying to resolve. Take the need to win out of the conversation. Here's the third one. Take the tone out. Take the tone out. Can you feel the tone in this conflict between Paul and Barnabas? You got to take the tone out. And here's my word. If there's tone and tension and emotions are high, you're not ready. You're not ready. And that's okay because we're going to get upset. Tempers are going to flare. They flared for Paul and Barnabas. Why would we think they wouldn't flare for us? But in that moment,
we've got to be honest and say to one another, you know what? We're going to say some things we're going to regret. Now is not the time to have this conversation. That's what the technique should have been for Paul and Barnabas. Look, we've been friends for too long. We've come together for too long. If we continue this conversation, I'm going to say something I'm going to regret. And you can imagine how the conversation went. Barnabas said, you know what? That's a good idea, Paul. We can take my cousin along with us. And Paul retorted back and says, no, we're not taking him. He quit on us. He ain't nothing but a little punk. We ain't taking him. And you can hear Barnabas say, look, I know you the great apostle Paul, but you ain't going to call my cousin a punk. You ain't too bad and too high that you think you can call my cousin a punk. And then Paul probably came back and said, hey, I'll call him whatever I want to call him. My mama raised me that I can say whatever I want to say. I can call him whatever I want to say. And before you know it, it was a back and forth of histories and past and all that kind of stuff. I can imagine Barnabas probably said, who do you think was on your side when nobody wants you? Now you're going to get all self-righteous with Mark and act like you done always had it together. It got nasty. The tone got out of control. And I'm telling you, we got to watch our tone. We got to take the tone out of it. And the principle is very simple. If the tone is there, you're probably not ready. If the tone is there, you're probably not ready. And many times we push people knowing good and well they're not ready. I've been guilty of that. And that's something I've even set as a goal, not to push when people are not ready. If the tone is there, you're not ready. We all need something to calm us down in the moment. I don't know what it is for you, but I think every Christian ought to have something. Every person ought to have something that calms them down in the moment. Maybe you need to count to 10. Maybe one brother says he pulls out a stick of gum and chews it. And by the time he's finished chewing the gum, that has helped him to calm down. Maybe you need to do like Ruth Bader Ginsburg, get you some earplugs and walk away. I don't know. Maybe you need to walk around the block. Maybe you need to go exercise for a minute. I don't know what it is, but all of us need some technique. Every person needs technique, something that we can lean into that when we become overheated, we say, wait a minute, let me step back off this. Let me let my emotions calm. Let me help the temperature gauge come down a little bit before we engage this. But there's one other issue I want to deal with here. And here's the issue that nobody wants to talk about. Tone is an indication of trauma, whether it's in me or it's in you. Tone is an indication that we are recycling our trauma. And when we vent and we give full expression to our anger, all we're doing is recycling our trauma. And I'm going to raise this issue, and I'm probably going to catch a little heat about it, but you know, I'm a preacher. That's what I do. But where do we get the idea in our culture that we have carte blanche right to say whatever we want to say to family and especially our children? That somehow God has given us this divine authority to say whatever we want to say to people who are vulnerable and who may actually be under our purview. And I'll tell you where it came from. And I'm not making an excuse. This is not a blame white folk issue. We surely need to own it, but many times we are recycling the trauma of slavery in how we talk to one another. There are plenty of great works on this. You can research it, but when you look at some of the behavioral and communication patterns of us in our community and look at how we had to try to survive slavery, you see the similarities. You can't get around them. I'm going to give you one. Case in point. We do now know for a fact that it was very common for parents to criticize, almost demonize their children while in slavery. And I know to many of us that doesn't make sense, but actually it was a survival technique. But history has confirmed that it was very common for men and women who were held as slaves to criticize publicly and demonize their children while in slavery. Because what would happen is if a teenage girl had reached the age of 14 and 15, it was not uncommon for a slaveholder to come to the mother and say something like this. Well, Missy, you know, your daughter there, she sure is coming along very fine. She's going to be a fine woman. Can't wait until she's all the way grown. Now, when a mother hears that kind of comment, we know he's not concerned about her educational pursuits. No, he's thinking sexual assault. So how did the mother in slavery respond to the slaveholder? She said, no, sir, she's no good. She's low down. You don't want anything to do with her. She's going to do nothing but disappoint you. And so we know from history now that as a survival technique and as a way to protect their children, parents would publicly shame and dog their children, trying to protect them from slaveholders and individuals that wanted to take advantage of them and cause them harm. And here's my question, because I know some of y'all asking the question, Pastor, why are you raising this? If a tablecloth from the Lord's Supper can be passed down to our times all the way from slavery in the church, what makes us think that we're not passing down how we mistreat one another, how we talk to one another, and how we even do each other? And I'm raising this issue, y'all, because this needs to change. It needs to stop. It needs to end. I am not making an excuse. I don't want us to be victims on this. We need to own it. And as a good friend of mine would say, he says it all the time, Pastor, I'm making sure all the curses die with me. In other words, whatever issues he had, whatever challenges he had, whatever flaws he had, he owned them. And he was going to do his best not to pass on to his children what had done to him. And I've made the same oath. I've made the same promise as well. I'm not going to pass on my anger to my children. I'm not going to pass on as best I can my flaws to my children. I'm going to try to kill the curse in my generation. And that's what we got to do as the people of God. I know it's tough. I know it's difficult. But some of you need to decide, you know what? Anger dies with me. Resentment dies with me. Bitterness dies with me. Talking about people for no reason dies with me. Being nasty with people dies with me. Belittling people dies with me. Talking down to people dies with me. And I'm going to turn this thing around. I'm going to bless somebody when I ought to curse them. I'm going to lift somebody up rather than tear them down. I'm going to bring joy rather than bring sorrow. We've got to make a decision that some things need to die with our generation if our future generation is going to have a chance at a better life. Tone. We got to watch the tone and take the tone out of it. Let me give you the last one. And the last one is simply this. We got to invite the Lord in. In the worst disagreements, the Lord is waiting to come in. And in this text, he wasn't invited in. But in later texts, and I give you three, Colossians chapter 4, verse 10, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 6, and 2 Timothy 4, verse 11, somehow, Paul made amends with Mark and Barnabas. I don't know how it happened. I love that about Luke. I love that about the gospel writers. They understood how to keep some things private. But at some point, God got in it, and they were able to make amends. They dealt with their disagreements. They bridged. I don't know how they did it, but they did it. If I can imagine, it probably went something like this. You know what, Paul? I probably said some harsh things that I should not have said. I own it. Man, I was wrong. We've been friends for too long. We go way back. I surely don't want it to end this way. Let's figure out a way through this together. I'm just imagining. Maybe Paul said something like this. You know what? I was wrong to call your cousin Mark a quitter. I know I would have gotten just as mad if somebody said something about my family the same way. Plus, man, you were there for me in Jerusalem. You were there for me in Antioch. When nobody wanted me, Barnabas, it was you that came and got me. And sometimes I get a little bit self-righteous and I forget about the grace of God. Let's get this thing right. That's how you get the Spirit in. Just open your heart. Share the truth. be as honest as you can. And even if people don't receive that, and I know there's some folk that will never receive that, at least you've done your part. At least you can stay true to your character. Lean into the technique, and that's how God helps us overcome our temper. I want to close with this. I want to close with what Ruth Bader Ginsburg commented about the advice her mother-in-law gave her. Here's what she said. Anger, resentment, envy, and self-pity are wasteful reactions. They greatly drain one's time. They sap energy better devoted to productive endeavors. Of course, it is important to be a good listener, to pay attention to teachers, coworkers, and spouses. But it also pays sometimes to be a little deaf. Your earplugs. I still use the brand of earplugs my mother-in-law gave me. Maybe that's what you need, is a pair of earplugs. Father, we bless you and thank you for your word. I truly believe that you have techniques that can help us with our communication. I believe you have brought us through a ton, and you surely want to deliver us even in our differences here. Whether it's Kurt and Carry On, or some of us that are unmentioned here, God, I believe you want to intervene even right now. So would you do it? Heal our broken hearts. Bridge the differences that we can't bridge. And Lord, give us language and tone so that we can actually work through our differences. And no, we know it's not going to be perfect, but it'll be better. And we will be better because you stop by and intervene. Give us the techniques to move beyond our temper. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Would you type that in the chat? Lean into the technique to move beyond the temper. Lean into the technique to move beyond your temper. God will give you the strength every time to overcome it. That's our communication goals. If you're watching this, I want to encourage you first and foremost, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, that ought to be your first goal right there, to get it right with Him. We're coming up on Resurrection Sunday. And to trust Christ means we trust a Savior who lives. We don't believe in a dead Savior. We believe in a living Savior. And the truth is, you probably can testify that there's some things in your life that have transpired or occurred that you cannot explain. That somehow something or somebody was watching over you and intervened and brought you to this point. We believe that's our Lord. We believe that's our Savior. And He doesn't just want to protect you and provide for you. He wants to be in relationship with you. And so if you're watching today and you've never trusted Christ, this is your moment. The gospel is very simple. Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. And the Bible teaches if you believe that, listen, He will save you. He will walk with you. He'll give you a purpose. He'll get in your most difficult relationships. He'll heal your broken heart. He'll teach you how to confess. He'll make you a better communicator. He'll do all that. That's the kind of Savior we serve. Do you want to trust Him today? Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we bless you and thank you again for this opportunity, the opportunity of the gospel. And Lord, somebody is watching right now who's never trusted you. And I know their hearts are open. And I know that heart has been shredded many times by loved ones, family, friends, and yes, even Christians and church people. But God, would you give them the faith to trust you today? Would you do that? If that's you and you want to trust Christ for the first time, I want to do the invitational prayer with you. It's very simple. Just repeat these words after me. And if you repeat them prayerfully, believing that God will save you, He will do it. Would you do that? Simply repeat these words after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you that you died and rose for my sins. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins. I accept you as my Savior and my Lord to make a difference in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We celebrate you. What a major step. You're talking about getting your communication right. When you get the communication right this way, it's going to get right this way. Boy, we celebrate you. We're proud of you. Excited. What a wonderful Palm Sunday celebration and gift. We need to connect with you. We want to help you with your next steps. That's all. We're not trying to shame you. We want to make this journey a great journey. And on the screen is some information for you to connect with us, life@ccrichardson.org. Would you connect with us? Would you do that? Would you connect with us? We surely would love to connect with you. Just email us your information. We'll follow up with you. We don't share information at all. We simply want to help you in your spiritual journey and in your newfound faith. God bless you. We are so proud of you. Maybe you're already a Christian, but you're not a part of a church family. Christ community would love to take you in. We're taking in people almost every day. We're taking people, a lot of people in right now. We'd love for you to be a part of that. And so I just need you to email us at life@ccrichardson.org. Let us know. Look, I'm already a Christian, but here's my information. I want to partner with Christ community. We'll follow up with you and we will share how you can do that. Whether you live in the Dallas area or whether you live abroad, people are becoming a part of this fellowship. And we would love to partner with you because we believe God has a super plan for you. And we want to be a part of helping you and see that come to reality. God bless you. May God keep you. To all of our guests, we're so glad that you've come to share with us. God bless you. We surely invite you to participate in all that we have to offer. And we know God is doing a work in your life. We simply want to help you experience all that God has for your life. Well, that's all I have. Christ community, friends, family, all who are watching, that's the word I believe God has for us. Let's lean into the technique to move beyond our temper. And I believe when we do that, God meets us by his spirit to overcome the greatest difficulties and differences in relationships and that we become a better people. Let's get the benediction. You are the light of the world. So go now knowing that if you lean into the technique, not only will he give you the power to overcome the temper, but also he'll give you the tools and the processes to build better and healthy relationships. And you yourself will be a better person too. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I'll see you Resurrection Sunday next Sunday. Take care.
The Lord that we serve cannot be killed. His reign is sure and supreme.